لبيك اللهم لبيك، لبيك لا شريك لك لبيك، إن الحمد والنعمة لك والملك لا شريك لك. لبيك اللهم لبيك، لبيك لا شريك لك لبيك، إن الحمد والنعمة لك والملك لا شريك لك. لبيك اللهم لبيك، لبيك لا شريك لك لبيك، إن الحمد والنعمة لك والملك لا شريك لك. لبيك اللهم لبيك، لبيك لا شريك لك لبيك، إن الحمد والنعمة لك والملك لا شريك لك. لبيك اللهم لبيك، لبيك لا شريك لك لبيك، إن الحمد والنعمة لك والملك لا شريك لك. لبيك اللهم لبيك، لبيك لا شريك لك لبيك، إن الحمد والنعمة لك والملك لا شريك لك.
Dear viewers, peace be upon you all everywhere in the world, and welcome to Iqra' channel. This is Good Morning Hajj, our program for today. لبيك اللهم لبيك، لبيك لا شريك لك لبيك، إن الحمد والنعمة لك والملك. Here I am, my Lord, here I am. All praise, all grace and dominion are yours. You have no associate, you have no partner. Here I am, my Lord, here I am. In today's episode, we will discuss Hajj from different points of view, from different angles. At the very beginning, let me welcome our guest, Dr. Abdullah Al-Sulaiti. Dear brother, welcome to this program.
Thank you very much for having me on this
program. Thanks a lot. You know, I would like to start with the story of Hajj, the origin of Hajj. How did it originate and what happened next?
بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم، الحمد لله رب العالمين، والصلاة والسلام على أشرف الأنبياء والمرسلين، نبينا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين. وبعد، حج، the rituals of Hajj and the practice of Hajj dates back all the way to Ibrahim alayhi salam, the father of all the prophets. Furthermore, if we want to trace it back further, we can say that there are certain ahadith that mention that the Kaaba was originally built by Adam alayhi salam. There is difference of opinion. However, the rituals of Hajj started with Ibrahim alayhi salam. Ibrahim alayhi salam, as you know, was present in the Sham region. And he was ordered to come to the deserted valley, which was at that time known as Bekka. And he was ordered to come here and to build, or to, shall I say, revive the bases of the Kaaba in order that people may come and perform Hajj. وَأَذِّنْ فِي النَّاسِ بِالْحَجِّ يَأْتُوكَ رِجَالًا. And call or proclaim to the mankind with Hajj, and people will come from all over the world. So we find the story originates with Ibrahim alayhi salam. If we go before that, we find that Ibrahim alayhi salam, he was ordered to come to Mecca and to leave his wife Hajar and Ismail, who was the young baby at the time. As Ibrahim left Hajar in the deserted valley of Mecca, في واد غير ذي زرع. This was a valley that there was no such greenery, no water, no forms of life whatsoever. هاجر عليه السلام. She was calling upon her husband Ibrahim. أو إبراهيم أو إبراهيم why you leaving us here أو إبراهيم why you leaving us here and he was because he was ordered to do so. There are many lessons we can derive from this.
That's the point.
There are many lessons we can derive from this story, and inshallah, I'll mention it. So he turned around. She said, did your Lord order you to do this? He nodded in the positive.
I say.
She said, if your Lord ordered us to do this, if Allah ordered you to do this, then he will never neglect us. So look, we can see the submission from Ibrahim alayhi salam. He was ordered to come all the way from Sham all the way to here.
Sham is known as Lebanon or Syria.
Syria, shall I say Palestine, that whole region there.
I see.
And to leave his family, his wife and his young baby. In a valley that was غيري ذي زرع. There was no form of greenery whatsoever, no life, no water, no nothing. So look at the submission to the commandments of Allah, that's one. And look at the tawakkul, also the reliance upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Furthermore, this is even present within Hajar alayhi salam. Because once she found out that this is from the orders of Allah, the commandments of Allah, she said, what did she say? She said, if Allah ordered you to do this, then you will never neglect us.
The God to Allah commands.
So, yes. So basically, it's complete submission from the beginning. And we can see this even during the rituals of Hajj now. As Ibrahim went, Ismail and Hajar were left, alayhi wasalam, they were left in Mecca. Ismail was crying out of thirst. There was no water. Hajar, alayhi wasalam, she was running between Safa and Marwa, the two mounts, in order to see if there were any caravans coming past, because it was very common at that time that the people of Yemen and the Qahtanis they used to pass by Mecca, at that region. She was worried for her son, obviously, her baby crying, thirsty, in a deserted valley, very hot. So she was running back and forth, and this is where the rituals of as-sa'i bayn as-safa wal marwa comes.
Seven times.
And obviously, if you picture how she must have felt at that time there, she was desperate. She really needs water, and she's calling upon her Lord, just how we should be. We should be following the footsteps of these successful...
To save her son and herself.
Save her son and herself. Yeah. So we should be, like, you know, following the pious, shall I say, footsteps of these pious people. When we go between Safa and Marwa, we need to be, you know, the same kind of, shall I say, muttar. We're calling upon Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in desperate. Yeah. So, again, there's a hadith that says, Jibreel alayhi salam, strike the floor, and Zamzam came up just under the feet of Ismail. So that was the water of Zamzam.
So it was full submission to Allah. Allah saved them.
And Allah saved them. And when you submit to Allah, all the doors open. Because it didn't stop there. It wasn't only Zamzam. Then after, obviously, when there is water, people start coming in, the caravans, because there's certain birds that they only fly over places.
Life is the source of life. Water is the source of life.
Source of life,
exactly.
So there are certain birds that fly over places where there's water. So when the people, the Arabian tribes, when they saw this, they know that there's water in that direction. So as time goes by, many tribes came and settled down in Mecca, and as a result, you know, Ismail, he grew up amongst the Arabs and he intermarried with them, and Mecca became a city. Later on, Ibrahim was ordered again to come back and to revive that bait. وَإِذْ يَرْفَعُ إِبْرَاهِيمَ الْقَوَاعِدَ مِنَ الْبَيْتِ وَإِسْمَاعِيلَ رَبَّنَا تَقَبَّلْ مِنَّا إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ السَّمِيعُ الْعَلِيمُ. And when Ibrahim and Ismail were reviving the bait, the foundation of the Kaaba, they were saying, "Oh, our Lord, accept from us. Verily, you are the All-Hearer. إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ السَّمِيعُ الْعَلِيمُ. The All-Hearer, the All-Knower." So this is when the Kaaba was built, and then, as time goes, the rituals, you know, the rituals of Ismail. Yeah. So we find that this, the origin of Hajj, most of these rituals and these acts of worship and these activities comes from the time of Ibrahim and Ismail. And as time goes by, the pagan Arabs, the pre-Arabian, or shall I say, the pre-Islamic Arabians, they changed it. And then the Prophet, peace be upon him, was ordered to, shall I say, revive it and, you know, make it upon the original form.
Purify
the rituals of Hajj. So as we said, there are many lessons we can derive from this story. The first, obviously, is complete submission. Even though this command would may contradict our intellect or may contradict our morality, what is right and what is wrong, am I to leave my wife in a deserted valley along with my newborn son.
And this is to remind us of the verse from the Holy Quran, when Allah the Almighty, the Glorified, ordains something, so there is no right to choose.
This is the attributes of the believers. They listen and they obey. They listen and they obey. So we know this full submission to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
And this is, as you know, in return for their strong belief in Allah, they trust Him. So once you trust someone, you take it from Him without any questioning.
Definitely, definitely. And we find nowadays, when it comes to, for example, as we mentioned in our previous conversation, you know, taking prescriptions from one doctor or, you know, someone who's a specialist in a certain field, we take from what he says, we don't question it. But when it comes to the affairs of our deen, we end up, you know, questioning. So first and foremost, we must realize that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is our creator. He's the creator of the heavens and the earth. He is the sustainer. He is the provider.
Nobody else, I think, claims that.
Yes.
So we have to believe in this.
We know this. And as a result, if we know that this is the case, the creator of the heavens and earth, is he not worthy of worship? Is he not worthy of submission, complete submission, complete reliance? So, as I said, the first lesson we can derive from this story is that of complete submission, even though it may contradict with our intellect or our morality. And we find this clear in the story of Ibrahim, when he was ordered to come here and to leave his wife and his child. Similarly, we find it in the case of Hajar, when she accepted the commandments of Allah, and she said, if Allah ordered you to do this, then Allah will not neglect us. This is true to us.
And something else, when we look at any worship, it's mainly for the good of man. Mankind, not only the Muslim community or the Muslim nation. When you do well according to Islamic teachings, it's for the good of all people.
Definitely.
How do you see that?
Yes, definitely. It benefits us. Allah is the creator of the heavens and the earth. He's the one who created us. He knows what's better for us. So every halal there is a benefit for us, though there is beneficial for us. And every haram, there is a harm for us. So this is what Allah has, shall I say, prescribed, and he has made as a part of our Islamic law. So of course, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows what's best.
The problem is that some people might rely on this fact, others don't.
Yes, well, it comes down to ignorance at the end of the day.
I see.
So back to the lessons of what we can derive from this story. We find Hajar, she had complete submission. Similarly is the case when it came to the story between Ibrahim and Ismail, when he was commanded as a test. He wasn't commanded to implement it itself, which is to sacrifice his son. It was only a test to see if he is going to, shall I say, fulfill, or shall I say, have the azm, meaning, you know, agree to it, or shall I say, you know, actually.
I think this was revealed to him in his dream.
Yes, in his dream.
And it's known as the dream of a prophet is something like reality.
Yes.
Right?
So again, here we can see that there was complete reliance and complete submission.
I see.
So at the end of the day, we need to realize that we are the servants of Allah. We were created to serve Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. I did not create mankind or jinn except that they worship me alone. So with this worship, we cannot fulfill this worship until we
fully surrender to His will.
To Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We implement His commandments and we abstain from His prohibitions. And this must be done sincerely for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala.
And we do as much as we can. وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ مَا اسْتَطَعْتُمْ.
وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ مَا اسْتَطَعْتُمْ. So we do as much as we can, because Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, لا يؤاخذكم الله أو شرع سيء لا يكلف الله نفسا إلا وسعها. Allah does not burden a soul above or more than what it can do. So if Allah orders us to do certain commandments, we do as much as possible.
And it's a matter of intention. It's very important for any deed.
This is the conditions for an action to be accepted. The first is that it must be out of sincerity. So one must worship Allah sincerely. وما أمروا إلا ليعبدوا الله مخلصين له الدين. And they were not ordered except to worship Allah
sincerely.
So all of this
and the second part is that to do it following the Prophet. So there are two conditions mainly for good work.
I'm going to come to the second condition. The first one, and again, the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam said in the Hadith al-Qudsi, whereby Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, "أنا أغنى الشركاء عن الشرك." I am more rich than to be associated in partners with. So whosoever associates partners with me,
I am in no need.
Sorry for interrupting, sir, but we have a shorter break and be right back. So, dear viewers, a shorter break and we'll be right back. Stay tuned.
اللهم لبيك لبيك لا شريك لك لبيك إن الحمد والنعمة لك والملك لا شريك لك لبيك الله.